Thank you. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die.
The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed.
Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me.
I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living.
The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms.
Be safe in Jesus Christ. We received the body of our brother Adrian for burial. Our brother was washed in holy baptism and anointed by the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise him to perfection in the company of the saints. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, remember before you this day our brother Adrian. We thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until, by your call, we are reunited with those who have gone before. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. We will now have the eulogy by Linda Cadogan.
We are gathered this afternoon to lay to rest and also to celebrate the life of Adrian Bernard Blenman, more familiarly known, especially to the Mylors Hill family and community, as Mobert. A son, a father, a big brother, a nephew, and so much more. When God woke us up on the morning of October 24th, 2022, no one expected that by the end of that day, our lives would be changed forever because of Mobert's death. From here on, I shall refer to him by his given name, Adrian, except when I'm reading a tribute from one of his family members. Adrian was born on the 19th day of October, 1975, to Veronica Cox and Adolphus Cadogan. And at the time, they both lived in Milors Hill, St. Michael. Adrian was the first grandchild of Branford and Hilda Haynes, and I'm told by his father, Adolphus, that when his mother, Veronica, was moving from Milors Hill, his grandmother, Hilda, said, "He's my first grandchild, and he's not leaving here." And so it was that Adrian grew up with his father, grandparents, aunts, uncles, and cousins in Milors Hill, and lived there until his death. His aunt Rosalind says Adrian seemed more like a little brother to them than a nephew. He was educated at Belmont Primary School, and then he went on to the Cooperative High School. And after leaving school, he worked at C.L. Gibbs for a bit, and then at a couple other places, but for the past 11 years, he worked at G4S, and he loved working there. Adrian was a very cool youngster, and when I first met him, he was about 9 or 10 years old, and throughout all the years that followed, he showed himself to be a very respectful, polite, and rather quiet. Adrian was married to Mary Blenman. Adrian has 4 children, Crystal, Christina, Kristen, and Malik. These are now some of the reflections from his children and some of his siblings. Crystal, his daughter, says, "I miss my father for playing music early in the morning, for the little picnics the family had together, and most of all for his karaoke." Crystal says that when they were growing up, she remembers her father always buying them a real Christmas tree and made sure that they received gifts at Christmas. Especially she remembers that pink and white bicycle that he bought as a Christmas gift and carefully hid it until this special day. She says, "As we grew, my dad would rent a car and take us driving all over Barbados, along with his brother, Jermaine. On those occasions, he would always buy us pizza," she says. That was one of his favorites. "And every Friday evening, he brought home snacks for the children." She says he was also well known to her last son as his dentist. Every time Tyrell had a shaken tooth, he would let Granddad Adrian know, and his response would be, "Bring paper and come." Crystal further remembers that Adrian was scheduled to pull a tooth for Tyrell on Tuesday, the 25th of October. But unfortunately, he took sick on the Monday and died. When Tyrell was informed of Adrian's death, his grandfather's death, his question to his mother was, in a sad voice, "So, Mommy, who will pull out my tooth now?" Crystal says that weekend preceding her father's death, they talked a lot, and that Monday morning before he died, he laid on her bed and he asked her to turn the fan on. She never thought that would be the last time that they would spend together. "I will miss the man of a few words," she said, "and funny at times. We had good times singing and dancing. I love you, Dad." This now is from his daughter, Christina. "I remember my father as a cool man, quiet, and always to the point. My friends would always say, 'Chris, your father vex.' And I would let them know that's how he always looked, just serious." She says she remembered when she was pregnant with her first child, Kimaya. And close to her due date, she was scared. So her father slept with her every night. And every movement she made, he would jump up with a, "What happening? You in pain?" And she would then have to reassure him that she was not yet. She said with her second child, he was a bit more relaxed, and they haven't traveled that way before. After her son, Crisio, was born and started growing up, Granddaddy Adrian would always bring fruit, yogurt, or snack for Jeremiah, as he would constantly call him. He said he liked that name and no amount of correcting him would work. So she settled for him calling her son Crisio Jeremiah. These other tributes now are from some of his brothers and sisters, aunt and companion, and I shall read them just as they were written. From his sister Suzette. My brother had many sides to him, but those that stand out are most are most memorable to me are his quiet, funny, and caring ways. Two examples come to mind, one many years ago, and one that lives fresh in my memory, even though it was not that recent. She said, when I lived alone in my apartment, which was never kept locked, because back then it was safe to do such things, my immediate family knew that they were welcome, and whether or not I was there, they were welcome. Most would always call ahead, but this was not the case with Adrian. One Sunday, I was at home in bed, and I heard movements in the kitchen. And on approaching the kitchen, I heard the TV turn on, only to see, when I got there, my brother sitting in a chair, foot up and a drink in hand. My facial expression said it all, to which he responded, I thought you were never going to get up. Try and sit down here and relax yourself. I just shook my head and did just that. And that afternoon, she said, we had a great chat. The second occasion was on July the 15th, 2010, when I was rushed to the hospital. And on hearing this, my brother ran from the bus terminal straight to the hospital in a panic. So he said that he could ensure that I did the right thing if it came to having to make a choice of life or death. He said he wanted me alive, and he was there to help me make the right choice. From his brother Joshua, I will certainly miss my brother, the only brother I had. When Adrian died, we were just beginning to get close together again. We had already made plans to go to the shooting range for a session together. This was to take place the week after he died. That was never to be. Morbert would always say to me, be careful out there. Keep your eyes alert. Don't let the young boys on the streets get free points on you. I will certainly miss my brother. From his aunt Brenda, Morbert came into my life not only as a nephew, but also as a son. It was a pleasure being available during his upbringing to help out my parents, his grandparents, whenever I was needed. Morbert, I am proud of the man you grew up to be, never disrespectful, a law-abiding man. We love you, Morbert, and we miss you, but I am happy that you will be buried with your grandparents and your aunt, who you love so much. From Auntie Roslyn, I am going to miss Morbert so much. He was my jack of all trades, my carpenter, my painter, my electrician, my stove fixer. There was nothing he could not do. On evenings when he arrived home from work, he would come straight at my door, hear him, what happening now? And on Saturday mornings, I only had to shout for Morbert, and I would hear him say, she want breadfruit picked now, you know. And with that, my breadfruits would be picked for pickled breadfruit to go along with the pudding and sauce. Sunday mornings, he would wake me up with gospel music. He loved singing, especially karaoke, even if he sang alone. Keep on singing, Morbert. From Sheldine, his partner, Adrian brought so much love and joy into our lives, Malik and I. He meant a lot to us, and he will be greatly missed. We have so many treasured memories, and he will always be in our hearts, as well as in the hearts of family members and friends. Rest in peace, Adrian. We will miss you, and we love you so much. Adrian leaves to mourn his mother, his father, his wife, his partner, his children and grands, his aunts, uncles, cousins, co-workers, and many friends. My prayer for you this evening is that God, the God of all comfort, will comfort you during the time of grieving. This evening, Adrian lies here in this box. His life on earth has ended, but we, his family members, friends, and co-workers, are still alive. We are at this funeral service this evening. It's not for the benefit of the dead, but it's for the benefit of those of us who are yet alive. So I say to all of us this evening, one of these days, where Adrian now is lying, we too will lay in the front of some church or somewhere else in a box. How will it be with us when that time comes? Hebrews 9:27 says, and it is appointed unto men once to die, but after death, the judgment. My encouragement, therefore, to all of us living this evening, the Bible says, now is the accepted time, now is the day of salvation. If you're currently not doing so, start living for Jesus. Get right with God and do it now. May Adrian rest in peace.
We will now have a tribute by Omar Osborne. Our tribute by G4S Source.
Good afternoon, church. My name is Derek Durant. I am the head of the Cast Services Division at G4S, and I'm here to deliver a tribute on behalf of the management and staff of G4S. And incidentally, our managing director from Trinidad, Mr. James Devers, is present, as well as Mr. David Eiffel, our operations manager. Adrian Blenman joined G4S family on October 23rd, 2011, as a security officer. Thank you. As a security officer with, that's good. Yes, I'll start again. So Adrian Blenman joined the G4S family on October 23rd, 2011, as a security officer with our team. He then transferred quickly into the cash in transit department as a CIT escort. Then within a short period of time, Adrian attained his license to carry a firearm on the job. And incidentally, he was a very good shot using his firearm as well. With the attainment of the firearm, he became one of the most flexible team members in the department, which means he could be selected to lead the team on a CAT vehicle as a crew chief. He could be selected to drive one of the vehicles when needed and also act in the role of an escort. And quite frankly, he did all of these positions extremely well. He also did very well in the specialized role as an ATM crew member. And that is a very specialized role, and he did well in that. And I'm sure Mark Callender and Andre Arthur, who are sitting here today, can attest to his knowledge and his skill at the ATM machines. So most people describe Adrian as cool and quiet. I agree for the most part. He was mostly cool and calm at work. And seldom would we see him flustered while doing his job, especially while doing the more demanding role of the crew chief, which he performed creditably when given the opportunity. Blenman's calm demeanor may have given the impression he was quiet, but he was not that quiet to the extent where he would not speak. Adrian would easily and often share his opinion on different matters during a meeting or in a discussion, but he was never boisterous or obscene with it. One of the G4S values is teamwork, and Adrian was definitely a team player. Adrian got along well with every single person in the department. I never heard any of his immediate colleagues have a negative thing to say about him. Adrian could be relied on, if asked, to fill an extra duty or to make an adjustment if there was a change made to his roster. Our CAT dispatcher, Carol Hayward Ford, can give countless times where Blenman would come to the rescue, so to speak, and help out where an extra hand was needed or extra time was needed in order to complete the task. Adrian embodied several of the G4S values. He was reliable, agile, and innovative, meaning adapting to many circumstances. He displayed teamwork and always acted with integrity. Our grief, however, is lessened only slightly with the comforting thought that we had the privilege to know him. Sorrow fills our heart on this sad occasion as Adrian has departed from us. Our lives will be empty in the areas that he had brightened for all of us here at G4S. But on behalf of the management and staff of G4S, we extend heartfelt condolences to his family and friends in this time of sorrow. May he rest in peace. Thank you.
Good afternoon to the church. On behalf of the accounts team at the Transport Board, where his father works, Adolphus, we do give our heartfelt condolences.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassion they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Summer and winter, springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses up above join with all nature with manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, a brand new mercy I see. All I have needed, thy hands have all ready provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hands have already provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
We will now stand and sing the hymn, "And Can It Be?"
Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Please sit for the ministry of the word.
We will now have the first scripture reading by Trisha Cadogan.
The reading is taken from St. John's Gospel, chapter 14, verse 1 to 6, and it reads, "Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you myself, so that where I am, there you may be also, and you know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where we are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And here ends the reading.
Please remain seated while we sing Psalm 23. Of Trichka Cadogan for the second reading.
Good evening. Today's reading is taken from the Revelations chapter 21, verse 1 to 7. This reading is taken from Revelation 21, verse 1, chapter 21, verse 1 to 7. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of the heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them, They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirst I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. Those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." Here's in the reading. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God. The hymn before the address, "It is well with my soul."
Thank you.
May I speak to you in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please sit. You and I are gathered here this afternoon because yet again life has brought us full circle. And if we think about that for a moment, we'll realize that life is indeed a circle. There is birth, there is the life we live, and there is death. And if we could visualize that circle, it could be the ring you are wearing or any circular object you can imagine. I am using the word circle because I'm persuaded that deep inside God's universe, there is no real beginning and no real end. We see on some funeral leaflets the notion that there is a sunrise and a sunset, with birth at sunrise and death at sunset. But I want to suggest this afternoon that there are continuous circles marking all kinds of events in your life and in my life as human beings. Some of these events are natural. Some of these events are traumatic. Some of these events are glorious, and some of these events are just ordinary. Some of these events we plan for. Some of these events just happen to us. Some of them we memorialize, and some we just want to forget. But all in all, we call them beginnings and endings by the nature of them. But I want to suggest that we should think about life and the events of life, and I am persuaded that we will begin to see the circular nature of life. At birth, we are beginning. When death happens, we call it an end. If and when we get married, we call that a beginning. If and when divorce happens, we call that an end. But think about it. The reality is that in any one event, in any one happening in your life and my life, we can both have a beginning and an ending. When we come to retirement, we think of that as yet another end. But if we are honest with ourselves, we can actually see that retirement is only an end of a certain kind of activity in life. But that retirement marks a beginning of something else. We might be retired from one kind of service, but we do not let ourselves give up work. I have this wonderful t-shirt that I wear quite often, which says, "I am retired. Do not ask me to do a thing." And yet here I am. Still working. We may assume a more relaxed job, but we never really stop working. Because you see, the only way that we as Christians know how to deal with death and the pain that comes with death is to think of death in terms of the resurrection. And therefore, I'm suggesting this afternoon that we need to think about and believe in the circle of life, because we see death not as an end. We as Christians think of death not as an end, but as an exit from life in this world to life in another realm. Death for us as Christians is just the gateway from life in this world to life in the nearer presence of Almighty God. And that is what our faith in God tells us. The reality is that every one of us is somewhere on that circle of life. Some of us mature, some of us graduate, some love, some follow a career through the successes and failures, and we live through the pleasures and the pain. And of course, we are here because Adrian chose to marry, have a family, experience the enrichments and sometimes the disappointments that life would have brought his way. And each of these choices, each of these life adventures is a circle within the larger cosmic circle of God's universe. Each time we complete a circle, each time we graduate, each time we fall in love, each time we become parents, each time we complete a career in retirement, each time we lose a loved one in death, each time we become a believer, in each of these we assess where we have been and we do some planning about where we go next. That is the way we put meaning and fulfillment into the circle and the circles of life. Always in an effort to save ourselves from the confusion from going and feeling adrift in the sea of life, it seems quite natural for us to ask ourselves some questions as we go through this circle of life. Who are we anyway? Why are we here as human beings? What are the factors that link us up with the people who are so important in our lives? Are we grateful for the life that we have? Are we telling those with whom we are connected that we are grateful? Are we telling those who are near and dear to us that we need and we love them? Are we being the kinds of persons that they need us to be as human beings in their lives? Sometimes some of these questions may be difficult to answer. Sometimes they may have no answers, and if they do, the answers may change from time to time. But each time we ask these questions and we ponder on these questions, they tend to bring us back to the center and to give us a sense of direction. And in the end, our lives become our answer to these questions. That is the essence of making the circle complete in your life and my life. We are living this circular existence. Somebody expressed it really well in verse, and they wrote, people come into our lives and walk with us a mile, and then because of circumstances only stay a while. They feel a need within, the days move quickly by, and then they're gone beyond our reach. We often wonder why. God only knows the reason why we meet and share a smile. We white people come into our lives and walk with us a mile. Adrian came, and Adrian walked his mile, and he shared his smile, and Adrian has moved on from this life to the presence of Almighty God. Sometimes we read the newspaper, and we watch our televisions, and we can see that faith and hope have a lot of subtle enemies. Sometimes we look at the world, and we see the doom and the gloom. We see the pessimism and the depression. We see the disillusionment and boredom and the fear that is out there. And there is a lot of negativism in the world. There is a lack of faith and a lack of hope. All of these things provide a rich seabed for indifference, insecurity, protectionism, and self-imposed fantasy-based guilt trips for many in this life. For there are a lot of people out there who give up on life. There are a lot of people out there who resign and let themselves become the victims of life's circumstances. There are a lot of people out there who reject the notion of God because they are unable to see purpose shining through the chaos, disorder, disaster, pain, and suffering that life brings. And therefore, this evening, this afternoon, we need to ask ourselves, how can we, in the midst of this grief that we share, how can we as persons who continue to live on in this life, how can we cut through the doom and the gloomy stuff of life and to see the promise that is to be found in a relationship with God? I want to suggest to us this evening that we treat life as if what happens to us is not as significant as how we manage it. And secondly, we all know that life is not easy, but let us cling to the victory that God in Christ claimed for us. For we are told that in the world we will have trouble, but let us not lose heart, for God in Christ has conquered the world. And friends, death is not the end of the circle. It is just the beginning of a new way of being. The death of a member of our family at such a young age is never easy to bear. I always say no parent should have to bury a child, but yet here we are this afternoon, and we share with you your loss. But we pray that God will grant rest eternal to Adrian, and that light perpetual will forever shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen.
After each petition, the response is, "Hear our prayer." We pray for those who mourn. We commemorate the departed Adrian. Let us pray with confidence to God our Father, who raised our Lord Jesus from the dead for the salvation of all. Grant, Lord, that your servant may know the fullness of life which you have promised to those who love you. Lord, in your mercy, be close to those who mourn. Increase their faith in your undying love. Lord, in your mercy, may we be strengthened in our faith. Live the rest of our lives in fellowship with your Son, and be ready when you call us to the fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy, show your mercy to the dying. Strengthen them with hope and fill them with the peace and joy of your presence. Lord, in your mercy, we commend all people to your unfailing love, that in them your will may be fulfilled, and we rejoice at the faithful witness of your saints in every age, praying that we share with them in your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please stand for the commendation. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints. Where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of humankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to the earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created us, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. As our Savior has taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us commend our brother Adrian to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Deliver your servant Adrian, O sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil, and set him free from every bond, that he may rest with all your saints in the eternal habitations, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Adrian. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. On behalf of the parish family here at St. Barnabas, we would like to extend our condolences to you as the relatives and friends of this, our deceased brother. During the singing of the next hymn, a collection will be taken that will go towards the organ fund, and you can give in memory of Adrian and his life and witness among you.
Precious Lord, take my hand. Thank you.
Thank you.
souls of all your servants, who, having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. May we, with all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Okay. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord. And let light perpetual shine upon him. May he and all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. him when the roll is called up yonder. In the sweet by and by.
Beautiful show
by,
in the sweet shall sing on that beautiful show. The melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirits shall sorrow no more. Not a sigh for the blessing of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
When we all get to heaven, sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansion bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place.
When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout. What a day
of rejoicing that will be
when we all see Jesus. We will sing and shout to him.
with you.
And also with you.
The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious unto him. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon him and give him his peace this day and forevermore.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Thank you. Be it to us.
My King.